Let's as always start with the current progress of Starship and the developments at Boca Chica. Then the number of working Starlink satellites has now increased to 415, and Elon has given approximate dates for the launch of the beta test. And now Falcon 9 officially became the US's most launched rocket. Further, there's an epic battle raging on the topic of the SLS Block 1B, so will it be built or will it be cancelled?
Last week we talked about Roscosmos being unhappy about SpaceX. So now they announced a price reduction of 39% for their launches, but will this be enough to save them? As for China, their 2020 Mars mission got a name. And yes, it's a name that cannot be easily translated into English, but it's still kind of cool. And we often speculated about the new Cold War between the US and China, and how this would impact space exploration. And lo and behold, the first newspapers are already picking up exactly our idea. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
So last week on Thursday, the 23rd of April, the latest iteration of Starship, the SN4, has been moved to the test stand or launch pad, as Elon tweeted, showing us this very impressive aerial shot of SN4 being lifted onto the launch mount by a crane.
And finally, the cryogenic pressure test with liquefied nitrogen has been successful. We are so happy that we don't have to show another explosion or collapse again, and that instead everything went well, as Elon informed us on Twitter. They went a bit soft on SN4, up to a pressure of only 4.9 bar. But Elon said that it will be absolutely enough to fly. Now only one Raptor engine will be installed on SN4, and then we will see the static fire test, which is already scheduled for the 30th of April. After that, so in early May, we will see a 150-meter hopping test, which will be absolutely spectacular. However, don't hold your breath to see the 20-kilometer skydiving maneuver with SN4.
Elon said that only SN5 or later versions will do this maneuver because only they will get 3 Raptor engines installed and also get the aerodynamic flaps necessary to perform such a maneuver. And he also said that they will soon switch to a new 300 series alloy away from the 301 stainless steel they were using before, because this will allow a higher ductility, meaning the new alloy can deform more at cryogenic temperatures before breaking, which is of course a very important property. He also said that some geometric changes will be introduced to Starship. Now we are certain it won't be a complete design overhaul, only some smaller design changes, but this is intriguing news nonetheless. We can't wait to find out more soon.
And Starlink is progressing at breakneck speed with another successful deployment of 60 Starlink satellites last week on the 22nd of April. This ups the number of working Starlink satellites to 415. We are now getting into the number range high enough for minor broadband coverage for North America. Of course, many more Starlink missions will follow in 2020. And Elon said that SpaceX will start internally beta testing the Starlink network within 3 months, with a public beta test to follow in 6 months. Therefore, we can expect Starlink to go online for the North America public, with luck, by the end of 2020 or early next year at the latest. And then the cash will start rolling in, enabling our interplanetary future. So just incidentally, Elon is disrupting another industry, which is of course not very happy with Starlink, namely the current telecom giant and the internet service providers. A lot of revenue will be breaking away from them very soon. That's by the way the reason why they are actively pushing the narrative that Starlink satellites are really bad and that they would destroy the night sky forever. This is of course total BS, but it makes for good clickbait headlines as always. And with the latest Starlink mission, Falcon 9 became the US's most flown rocket, with 84 performed flights in just under 10 years. Falcon 9 took the crown from the ULA's Atlas V, which has flown 83 times in 18 years. The paradigm shift from the old inefficient contractors such as the ULA to the new streamlined and much more efficient companies such as SpaceX has now reached the point of no return for the old companies. They are seeing themselves being brutally disrupted by SpaceX, a trend which will just accelerate even more in the next years.
So last week we said that apart from the ULA, Roscosmos is also getting totally hammered by SpaceX, pushing them to make some really ridiculous statements about which we talked in this video here, and also forcing them to reduce their prices, which they now did by 39%. But will that price reduction be enough to save them? Hint, no. That was surprisingly anticlimactic. Let's do a quick price analysis. The Falcon 9 costs approximately $50 million per launch for a reused booster and $60 million for a new one. With a 22 metric ton LEO payload capacity, we get a nice $2,700 per kilogram worst case number and a $2,300 per kilogram best case number. Now the latest Russian Soyuz 2.1 rocket iteration can carry 8.2 metric tons to low Earth orbit and costs about $50 million per launch. This gives an absolute best case number of about $6,000 per kilogram. But this would result in absolutely no earnings at all. Roscosmos stated in some press releases that they actually charge $20,000 to $30,000 per kilogram. So let's take the lowest number, 20,000, and reduce it by 39%. This would yield $12,200 per kilogram as the lowest possible number which Roscosmos could ask. But this is still 5 to 6 times higher than the price SpaceX is offering. So yeah, no matter what Roscosmos will try, it won't work, simply because they don't have reusable rockets, and therefore never can compete with SpaceX. They slapped on reusable rockets, same as ULA, and both will therefore play a less and less prominent role until one day in the not too far future, both will end in total insignificance. Those two launch providers, ULA and Roscosmos, will in the not too distant future be only a faint memory of a long bygone era, a dark age of space exploration where humanity was still extremely wasteful and threw away the entire rocket after every single launch like total morons. An era which will seem very archaic in only a few decades' time. Talking of archaic, what is our favorite archaic rocket doing? Yes, the giant taxpayer money pit called SLS, also known as Senate Launch System.
Turns out, Congress and the White House are battling each other on the larger iteration of SLS, the SLS Block 1B, with the so-called Exploration Upper Stage, EUS. This is basically a more powerful version of the SLS, with a payload capability of up to 37 metric tons to the moon, compared to the 26 metric tons of the SLS Block 1. The EUS can house a bigger payload, with a 68% larger diameter of up to 8.4 meters, therefore enabling more massive payloads to be deployed onto the surface of the moon. Now, in a recent interview, NASA's SLS program manager John Honeycutt said that NASA's EUS team co-located with Boeing's EUS team in the same building at NASA's Michoud assembly facility. Currently, the employees are of course teleworking. However, the original plan is to accelerate the development of the EUS. The EUS is backed by Congress. We wonder why. Maybe some senators, for example, like this guy here from Alabama, have some personal interest to keep some jobs in Huntsville, and therefore their political power? The White House, however, is not happy with the EUS, since it won't be needed for the earlier Artemis missions. For example, the planned moon landing Artemis 3 in 2024 won't require the SLS Block 1B with the EUS expansion. Artemis 3 will launch with the regular SLS Block 1 crew version, which will contain a command service module based on the Orion architecture, and a moon lander, of course. By the way, NASA will soon announce the contractor for this human-rated lunar lander. And in best case, the SLS Block 1B with the EUS could be ready by 2025. So realistically, more like 2026 or 2027. And by then, it will certainly become obsolete, because this bad boy here will be able to deploy at least 100 metric tons of cargo onto the surface of the moon, 3 times as much as the SLS Block 1B with the EUS. So we are with the White House on this one here. We agree that the Block 1B with the EUS doesn't make any sense at this point. Of course, we know that the whole SLS actually doesn't make any sense. But until SpaceX's Starship is ready and demonstrates moon landings, which we think will happen in a few years' time, we will probably have to live with the SLS Block 1.
And meanwhile, China has released the name of its upcoming first robotic Mars landing mission, which is set to launch in July this year to the Red Planet. It will consist of an orbiter, a lander, and also a rover. And now the name has been released, and you guessed it, it's a name from Chinese mythology which no one can pronounce. From a poet that lived 2300 years ago. The name is Tianwen, and would literally translate it mean something like asking the universe, or universe asking the universe for answers, or something like this. Chinese language, fascinating language, but also insane language. But still a very nice and poetic name, and we hope that despite the crisis, China will be able to launch this amazing Mars mission in July this year.
Talking of China, we already mentioned quite a few times on this channel how China will become the new Soviet Union. Our theory is that the Chinese pushing into space will awaken the power of Uncle Sam, because we know that Uncle Sam sometimes likes to sleep. But when someone dares to awake the sleeping giant, he is capable of extraordinary accomplishments. Admiral Yamamoto knew it when he said, "I fear we have awakened a sleeping giant." So now China might have awakened the sleeping giant. Sure, the current economy looks not really good, and the crisis is still in full swing. However, remember that not long after the Great Depression in the last century, the US emerged as a giant superpower because its enemies rallied the people behind a common cause. And recoveries are often unexpectedly strong after severe crises.
And now look at this article from the Washington DC-based newspaper The Hill. Link in the description. NASA's Artemis program is a perfect response to China's virus cover-up. The paper further writes, "An American-led return to the moon as soon as possible and the development of its resources by Western countries would constitute both a psychological and economic blow to China. It would literally deny Beijing the mandate of heaven and demonstrate the cost of the antagonism and dishonesty that caused the virus disaster while garnering wealth for the West." This, dear viewers, is exactly the development we were talking about when we prophesied the possibility of a new Cold War in space.
So do you think a 39% price reduction from Roscosmos will be enough to save them? Or will they be put out of business by SpaceX very soon?
And do you agree with the newspaper The Hill that Artemis would be the perfect response to show China who's the boss, you know, who's the boss?
So now you just watched the JI Space Report. And lately we started a new Starship Flaw Fix series,
where we basically talk about the flaws of Starship and how to overcome them for a safe journey to Mars. You can watch the videos right here. So then I would say, on to the future.